Hello everyone, this is Satisha Kumar K, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Vivekananda College of Engineering and Technology, Puttur. Today I am going to deal about second part of module number 2 under automobile engineering subject, that is brakes. For this topic, I referred textbook called Automobile Engineering by Kripal Singh. Brakes. Brakes are used as a stopping medium to stop or slow down the vehicle or to prevent the vehicle movement when it is parked. During parking time, we are using parking brakes. During braking, the kinetic energy of the vehicle is dissipated as heat and is the reverse of accelerating a vehicle. When driving a vehicle, engine torque produces a tractive force or tractive effort at the driving wheels, and during braking, the braking torque at the brake drums produces a negative tractive effort or retarding force at the braking wheels. Similar to acceleration, the retarding force and the rate of deceleration are also limited by adhesion available between tire and the ground. The brakes must be capable of decreasing vehicle's speed faster than the engine acceleration it. While moving down a steep gradient, the brakes are used to control the vehicle and brakes remains in action for a long period. This needs efficient cooling of the braking system. Without the cooling system, the brake shoes are wear out easily, and burning of the brake shoe should be happen. The main function of brake is to develop suitable retarding force to stop the vehicle within minimum possible distance and convert kinetic energy of vehicle into heat, which being dissipated to atmosphere. To perform this, the brake system has to satisfy some of the requirements. First requirement is the brake must produce maximum possible retarding force and deceleration, irrespective of vehicle speed, road condition, and types of load. Second one, irrespective of road condition and load, the pedal effort required should be same. The response of the braking system should be minimum possible. The brakes must have good anti-fade characteristic. The brake effectiveness should not decrease due to prolonged applications. This needs efficient cooling of the braking system. In an emergency, the brake must be strong enough to stop the vehicle, and in the meantime, driver must have proper control over the vehicle. Next one, the brake system should not affected by water, dust, road, grits, etc. Next one, braking system should produce less noise and vibrations. These are the requirements. The types of brakes. Automobile brakes are classified by considering several factors. In that first factor, based on purpose, they are classified into primary and secondary brakes. Primary brakes are the service or main brakes which are used to stop the vehicle within a minimum possible distance when vehicle is in motion. Second brakes are the parking brakes, which are used to stop the vehicle on a slope when it is in stationary condition. Under types, second factor, the based on location. The transmission brakes and wheel brakes. Transmission brakes are located at the transmission where wheel brakes are at the wheels. Next one, based on construction. Based on construction is classified into drum brakes and disc brakes. Depending on the construction, brakes are classified into disc, drum and air brakes. Based on the method of actuation, mechanical, hydraulic, vacuum and air brakes. Based on the extra braking effort, servo assisted or power assisted brakes are present. This is the classification of or types of brakes. Drum brake. The drum brakes are most commonly used, and brake shoes are actuated by mechanical means, cam or toggle lever, and makes contact with the inside of the brake drum. The rods and levers decreases the pedal effort required by the driver through mechanical advantage or lever. The schematic representation of drum brake as shown in figure. This consists of a brake drum which is fixed to the hub of the rod wheel, and the back plate is mounted on the axle casing. On the front axle side, the back plate is fixed to the steering knuckle through bolts. The expander, anchor and brake shoe all are supported on the back plate, which is made from pressed steel sheet. It protects the drum and shoe assembly from mud and dust, as it absorbs the complete torque reaction of the shoe. It is also called as torque plate. Two brake shoes, which are semicircle in shape, are anchored on the back plate. That one you can see in drawing, the semicircular shaped structure, that one the brake shoe. Friction lining are attached on the outer periphery of the brake shoe, that one in the black and color. Black color is the brake lining, through which it makes contact with the drum. The brake shoe rub against wheel rim through friction lining and locks the wheel. One or two retractor springs are used, which keeps the brake shoe always away from the drum when brakes are not applied. The brake shoes are anchored at one end, and on the other end, force is applied by using some brake actuating mechanism, maybe an expander or wheel chamber. The expander is operated by using link rod, which is connected to the brake pedal. The expander forces the brake shoe to rub against revolving wheel drum from inside, thereby applying the brakes. An adjuster serves to adjust the wear of friction lining with use. Disc brake. This is another type of disc brake. The schematic representation of disc brake as shown in figure. It consists of two pistons, two friction pads, and one caliper and revolving disc. The two pistons always enclosed in a caliper. One end of the piston is connected by one friction pad, another piston, another end connected to the friction pad, which is as shown in figure. The disc brake differs from drum brakes in the use of heavy disc or rotor, which replaces the drum. The disc is bolted to the wheel hub and revolves with it. The caliper is a stationary housing connected to axle casing or stub axle. and consists of two hydraulic pistons. To the end of which brake friction pads are attached, one on each side of the disc. Passages are drilled in the caliper for the fluid to enter and leave each housing. Disc brakes has excellent cooling characteristic, making it highly resistant to break or fade. Coming to working of disc brake. When the brakes are applied, hydraulic pressure is built up behind the pistons and the friction pads are forced inward against the revolving disc, providing braking effort. This force of the friction pads on both sides will retard the disc. On releasing the brakes, the rubber sealing rings act as a returning spring and causes the pistons and hence friction pads to move away from the disc, thereby releasing it. Here rubber sealing rings that are not shown in figure, the requires high operating force than drum type. More than one caliper may be used, but this reduces the cooling rate. The torque output of the disc brake is found out by using formula called capital letter T equal to mu into capital letter W into R into small letter N. Here capital letter W equal to force applied to each of the friction pads, N small letter N number of friction pads, capital letter R mean radius of friction pad, capital letter R equal to small letter R1 plus R2 divided by 2. This torque output is not affected by the direction of disc rotation. This is the working and torque equation of disc brakes. Brakes. Brakes are used as a stopping medium to stop or slow down the vehicle or to prevent the vehicle movement when it is parked. During parking time, we are using parking brakes. During braking, the kinetic energy of the vehicle is dissipated as heat and is the reverse of accelerating a vehicle. When driving a vehicle, engine torque produces a tractive force or tractive effort at the driving wheels, and during braking, the braking torque at the brake drums produces a negative tractive effort or retarding force at the braking wheels. Similar to acceleration, the retarding force and the rate of deceleration are also limited by adhesion available between tire and the ground. The brakes must be capable of decreasing vehicle's speed faster than the engine acceleration it. While moving down a steep gradient, the brakes are used to control the vehicle and brakes remains in action for a long period. This needs efficient cooling of the braking system. Without the cooling system, the brake shoes are wear out easily and burning of the brake shoe should happen. The main function of brake is to develop suitable retarding force to stop the vehicle within minimum possible distance and convert kinetic energy of vehicle into heat, which being dissipated to atmosphere. To perform this, the brake system has to satisfy some of the requirements. First requirement is the brake must produce maximum possible retarding force and deceleration, irrespective of vehicle speed, road condition. The second type is sliding caliper type. A sliding caliper type consists of two pistons P1 and P2, and the high pressure fluid directly exerts pressure on one friction pad B through the piston P1. The piston P2 causes the caliper to move slightly right, thereby moving the friction pad A attached to it. Thus, the friction pad A exerts pressure on the disc. Through the sliding motion of the caliper and required braking effort can be obtained. This is all about working and construction of sliding caliper type. Coming to comparison of disc and drum types of brakes, carefully see the points. This question normally come in external exams. Total 8 points you are right. Total important 8 points. Coming to hydraulic brakes, this is the schematic representation of four-wheel hydraulic brakes. So, four brake drums you can observe, four wheel drums you can observe, brake shoes also you can observe, steel tubing lines you can observe, distributing block you can observe, and one master cylinder you can observe. Then linkage and brake pedals. The basically the car hydraulic brake system consists of a master cylinder, steel tubing to form connecting lines, and one or two or four wheel cylinders for each wheels. In this type, the pedal force is transmitted to the brake shoe through brake fluid. The force applied to the pedal is multiplied and is transmitted to all the brake shoes. The brake fluid is incompressible and it exerts equal pressure in all the directions. The brake pedal force is equally applied on all the wheel cylinders and produces equal braking effort on all the wheels. This force transmission is based on Pascal law, which states that when pressure is exerted on a confined liquid, it transmits pressure without loss equally in all directions. When the driver operates the brake pedal, it exerts a force on the piston of master cylinder, which is being transmitted to each wheel cylinder. The piston in the wheel cylinder transfer this force to the brake shoes, maybe decreased pressure or decreased force or increased force depending on the piston area. This force is transferred to the brake shoe. The movement of piston in master cylinder causes the piston in wheel cylinder to move until the brake shoe engages the revolving brake drums. If an attempt is made to depress the depress the master cylinder piston beyond this point, will transmit only pressure but not motion. A small pressure of about 50 kilopascal is maintained in steel piping to keep the wheel cylinder piston in the expanded position when brakes are not applied. This avoids entry of air into wheel cylinder when the brakes are released. This is the working of hydraulic brake system of four wheels. Master cylinder is the heart of the hydraulic brake system, in which hydraulic pressure is developed. Its working is similar to a pump and converts the mechanical force on the brake pedal into hydraulic pressure. This is the schematic representation of master cylinder. Very important topic in this chapter. Coming to construction of master cylinder. Essentially, it consists of a supply tank or a reservoir and compression chamber in which the piston operates. The reservoir will supply additional fluid when needed to compensate for loss of fluid in the pipeline due to temperature variations and due to minute leakage. The air vent provided in the cap will keep the brake fluid always at atmospheric pressure and allows expansion and contraction of the fluid without forming pressure or vacuum. The compression chamber consists of a aluminum piston which is covered with rubber seals on both ends to prevent leakage of braking fluid. You can see in drawing. The inner face of the piston presses against a rubber primary seal, and this prevents leakage past the piston. The outer piston end has a rubber secondary seal to prevent fluid from leaving the master cylinder. The inner piston head has several small bleeder ports or piston holes that pass through head to the base of the rubber primary seal. The piston is prevented from coming out by using stop washer and circlip as shown in figure. The circlip and stop washer. Circlip is also called as snap ring. A push rod is used to apply the pressure and it connects the piston to the brake pedal linkage. A fluid check valve with a rubber cup inside held against a rubber seat by a coil spring. The spring presses against the check valve while the other end is against the piston primary seal. This serves to retain the residual pressure in the brake lines even when the brakes are released. On the primary seal side, a number of holes are located in the piston head. The bypass port and intake port are used to connect the fluid reservoir to compression chamber. Now coming to working of master cylinder. When the brake pedal is pressed, when the brake pedal is pressed. Push rod moves the piston inward. Here, left. Against the spring force till it covers the bypass port. With the bypass port closed, the further movement of the piston build up the pressure in the compression chamber. This pressure forces the check valve inner rubber cup to open and pass fluid into the lines. This fluid enters the wheel cylinder and causes the piston in it to move outward and force the shoes tightly against the rotating drum, thereby applying brakes. When the brake pedal is released, pressure from the brake shoe return springs forces fluid back against the check valve and the master cylinder piston moves outward, here right side direction, due to spring action in the master cylinder. The fluid under pressure will lift the check valve off its shaft, allowing fluid to return to the cylinder. The spring force in the master cylinder keeps the fluid check valve pressed on its seat for some time and hence delay the return of fluid from the lines to compression chamber. Some delay is also caused by fluid inertia in the line. This creates the vacuum in the compression chamber and would result in air leakage into the system and makes the brake useless. This problem is avoided by having an intake port as shown in figure. As vacuum is created, the fluid reservoir in which the fluid is at atmosphere pressure forces the fluid through intake port and holes in the piston, which deflects the rubber cap or rubber cup and enters the compression chamber, thereby destroying the vacuum. In this way, a complete column of liquid is always maintained between master cylinder piston and wheel cylinder piston, ready for the next brake application. This is the working of master cylinder. Power brake. Power brake is an equipment which uses external source of energy to apply brakes in heavy vehicles. When the vehicle weight is more, driver cannot apply the brakes comfortably without fatigue. Some external force of energy or external source of energy is used to supplement his effort, which makes the brake application easier. For this reason, many of the vehicles are equipped with power brakes. The power brake are used to reduce the amount of pedal pressure necessary to stop the vehicle. If energy of these brakes are taken from the transmission of the vehicle itself, which partly helps the driver, that is, driver still has to put some effort while applying the brakes, then the such brakes are called servo brakes or power assisted brakes. Practically, when none of the braking effort is applied by the driver, then the brakes are termed as or called as power brake or power operated brakes, that one given in this slide. Now coming to figure, you can see engine vacuum air vacuum is given. The mechanical servo were used initially, but these have become obsolete after the introduction of vacuum operated servo. In vacuum operated or vacuum servo brakes, the brakes are applied by the engine suction from inlet manifold. That is, the brake, the pressure of you can get from the engine suction from the from inlet manifold. A small vacuum reservoir may be provided to have enough vacuum for several brake applications even after engine has stopped. Vacuum servo brakes are of two types. Both type consists of a piston or a diaphragm operating in a cylinder and are incorporated with the suitable linkage of or linkage for braking application. In the first type, on the both side, piston is exposed to atmosphere. When the brakes are applied, engine vacuum will act on one side of the piston, and the differential pressure on the both sides of the piston causes the linkage to operate the brakes. In second type, the bottom one, both sides of the pistons are subjected to vacuum when the brakes are in the released position. When brakes are applied, one side of the piston is exposed to atmospheric pressure, and the differential pressure on the both side of the piston causes linkage to operate. This system is more rapid in operation and hence preferred over the first type. The second type is called suspended vacuum system. The second figure is the suspended vacuum system. The figure shows the simplified power brake system. It consists of a piston and cylinder arrangement. A master cylinder piston is connected to the one side of the piston and other side of it is connected to the brake pedal. A vacuum control valve is placed between the brake and the piston. This valve admits vacuum to one side of the piston while the other side is kept at atmospheric pressure. This valve can also allow atmospheric pressure to reach both sides of the piston. This is the construction of simplified power brake system. Coming to working, when brakes are applied, the control valve closes off the atmospheric pressure to the master cylinder side of the piston, that is on the right side of the piston. Further movement of the brake pedal opens the vacuum inlet passage to this same side, and thus vacuum acts on this side of the piston. So on the left side, atmospheric pressure is acting and a partial vacuum is acting on the right side of the piston. This differential pressure forces the piston to move to the vacuum side. As the master cylinder piston is connected to this piston, say P, it moves towards right and thus apply pressure to the brake system. The power brakes are three stages of operation: brake released, brake applied, holding, constant apply pressure. This is the working of simplified power brake system. Another type of power brake system, that is vacuum servo brake system. Vacuum servo brake system. This is the schematic representation. It consists of a vacuum reservoir which is connected to the inlet manifold between carburetor and engine. It is also consists of a servo cylinder, one side of which is connected to vacuum reservoir through control unit, while the other side it is direct connection. The control unit is provided with a piston and two valves, say A and B, that we can see in drawing, valve A and B. Through upper valve A, atmospheric pressure acts on the left side of the piston in servo cylinder. When the valve A is open, when lower valve B opens and A closes, vacuum acts on the left side of the piston in the servo cylinder. On the right side of the piston in the servo cylinder, always vacuum will be acting. Through master cylinder, the brake pedal operates the piston in the control unit. This is the construction of vacuum servo brake system. Coming to working, when the brake is released position, valve A is closed and valve B is open. Thus, engine vacuum is acting on the both side of the piston in servo cylinder. When brake is applied, the pressure of the brake fluid pushes the control unit piston up and hence closes valve B and opens valve A. This opens left side of the piston in servo cylinder to atmospheric pressure. While on the right side, vacuum is already acting. The differential pressure causes the piston to move towards right and is used to apply the brakes through suitable linkages, which may be mechanical or hydraulic. This system reduces the driver's fatigue considerably, and the practically engine vacuum supplies whole of the brake effort. This is the working of vacuum servo brake system. Next, coming to air brakes. This is the schematic representation of air brake or layout of an air brake system. As vehicle weight increases, heavier braking effort is required to stop the vehicle. Compressed air powered brakes are suitable for these heavy vehicles. These brakes consist of flexible diaphragm in brake chambers and are connected to the brake rods and controlled by hand or foot operated valve. The compressed air pressure acts on flexible diaphragm. The brake rod connect to brake operating cams on the wheel brakes. The braking operation is controlled by a brake valve, which directs the airflow from reservoir against the diaphragm in the brake chambers during brake application and from the brake chambers to the atmosphere when brake is released. Coming to layout of an air braking system. The filtered air from the compressor passes to the reservoir through the unloaded valve, which sends the air at a predetermined reservoir pressure about 900 kilopascal. The reservoir supplies air to various accessories and diaphragm units or brake chamber at each wheel through the brake valves. In the air brake system, dust and other matter present in the air is removed by passing it to the air filter, so that you can remove the dust particles and other matters. Then an air compressor driven by the engine raises the pressure of air to the required level and supplies high pressure air to brake chamber at wheels through unloaded valves. This valve mainly consists of a governor valve, plunger and non-return valve, and regulate the brake line pressure in the system. A reservoir or air tank made from steel sheet stores the compressed air at a specific pressure and is used for brake application. The reservoir is also provided with a safety valve to control the air pressure in it. The brake valve or application valve is used to regulate the braking intensity in an air pressure system. The brake valve supplies air to the various brake chambers at the required pressure. One brake chamber is installed on each wheel. In the brake chambers, the pressure energy of compressed air is converted into useful mechanical work, that is piston movement, and is used for brake application. This is the working of air brake system. Coming to new concept called anti-lock braking system. Main use of this one: during emergency braking, it can be difficult to control the vehicle due to the wheel locking up problems. But if you use ABS in a vehicle, anti-lock braking system in a vehicle, you can prevent the wheels from the locking to reduce stopping distance. The purpose of anti-lock braking system is to control the rate at which individual wheels accelerate and deaccelerate through the regulation of the line pressure applied to each foundation brake. The control signal generated by the controller and applied to the brake pressure modulating unit are derived from the analysis of output taken from wheel speed sensor. Thus, when active, the anti-lock brake system makes optimum use of the available friction between the tire and the road surfaces. So below example, you can see front wheel skidding. In the first figure, with ABS, how we can, without any disturbing the traffic or the component, that got one red pole, you can see, without touching that one, easily vehicle will move in sudden condition. But if without ABS, it will directly hit the poles, red pole, left side also. If vehicle in a high speed, sudden and slippery surfaces, sudden curve comes. If you didn't have ABS system, that will be vehicle directly hit to the side barricades or trees, damage will happen. But if you use anti-lock brake system, due to traction control, it will stability to the driver, so that easily driver can turn the vehicle in a suitable direction. That is the use of anti-lock braking system. The anti-locking braking system. This is a schematic representation. Main part of this system is speed sensor, valves, pump, controller. That one you can see in drawing. Speed sensor, valves, here solenoid valve you can get, pump, then controller, ABS control unit can get, and pumps you can get inside the hydraulic unit. Sensors are directly connected to the wheels. Now speed sensor. The purpose of speed sensor is to monitor the speed of each wheel and then to determine the acceleration and deacceleration of the wheels. It consists of exciter and a wire coil or magnet assembly which generates the pulses of electricity as teeth of exciter pass in front of it. Coming to valve, the function of valve is to regulate the air pressure to brakes during anti-lock braking system action. They are placed in the brake line of each brake controlled by the ABS. In most of the case, the valves has three positions. In position 1, the valve is open, the pressure from the master cylinder is passed through the brake. In position 2, the valve blocks the line, resulting in isolating the brake from the master cylinder. In position 3, valve releases some of the pressure from the brakes. Coming to pump, the purpose of the pump is to regulate or restore the pressure back to the brakes that has been released by the valves. Coming to controller, the controller of the anti-lock braking system consists of electronic control unit which processes all the ABS information and signal functions. The ECU gets the information from the wheels and then control or limit the brake force to the each wheel. Now, working of anti-lock braking system or ABS. When the brakes are applied, fluid is forced from the master cylinder to the hydraulic control unit inlet port with the help of open solenoid valves that are connected in the hydraulic control unit. Then through the outlet port of hydraulic control unit to the each wheels. The rear part of the master cylinder feeds the front brakes and vice versa. After the fluid is inserted in each wheels, the wheel starts locking up. When the control module senses that wheel is going to lock up, it closes the normally open solenoid valves from that wheel. The anti-lock brake control module then looks the looks at anti-lock brake sensor signal from the affected wheel. Once the affected wheel comes back up to the speed, then the control module returns the solenoid valve to their normal condition. Likewise, anti-lock brake system work takes place. During normal disc braking, sudden braking, that wheel will be locking position takes place. But here, depending on the condition, once times during braking condition, lock up, lock release, lock up, lock release. Like that, operation will be take place. That is the working of anti-lock braking system. That completes the second part of module 2, that is brakes. For more information, in the description box, I will give you YouTube links of anti-lock brake system and other system also. You can go through it. Thank you for watching.